Hi everybody, welcome to Modi's English class. Today I am going to teach another poem, and it is another inspiring poem, and the name of the poem all of you know, as it is written the board, a Sham of Life. Sham of Life. What do you mean by Sham of Life? Sham means song or hymn. Okay, so Sham of Life means a song of life. So this is definitely an inspiring poem and very good poem. Lot of messages there, lot of morals there in this poem. And it is written by another famous American poet. And what's the name? Look, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. He is famous for his inspirational poem, for his inspiring poem. And here we are going to read that poet who has written the poem that is a Sham of Life. Very good poem for the second year students, for class 12 students, but it is helpful to all the generations to come to learn the lessons of life. And he is the only first US citizen to be honored in the Poets Corner of Westminster Abbey, London. And this poem is inspirational in the history of literature. It gives the message that our life is a solemn virtue. All our life is a solemn virtue, and this life should be fruitful, and we must progress further, and our footprints should be followed by the young generations, the generations to follow. So that's why, how can we make our life fruitful? How can we make our life substantial? This is the message of the poem, definitely inspiring for everyone, inspiring to every category of people. Let us start. So the first stanza, all of you look at it. Tell me not in mournful numbers, life is but an empty dream. For the soul is dead that slumbers, and things are not what they seem. So in the very first stanza, the poet has opined that poet has rejected three things of life. What are the three things of life the poet has rejected? Let me tell you, what are the three things the poet has rejected? First one, life is but an empty dream. According to the poet, life cannot be an empty dream. Lot of people say, when they are defeated in the life, they say that life has no value, life is meaningless, life is an empty dream. But according to the poet, life cannot be an empty dream. So these three ideas poet has challenged. Look at the first line. It is always confusing to the students of English literature. What they say, they don't understand. They always ask a question, sir, whether poet has accepted these three views or not. No, the poet has not accepted these three views. The poet has rather rejected. And look at the first. Tell me not in mournful numbers. So what do you mean by mournful numbers? This is the line. All of you look. Mournful numbers. Mournful means sorrowful. Numbers means, what is the meaning of numbers? That is songs. Don't tell me in sorrowful songs what? Life is but an empty dream. The poet has rejected the idea that life will be considered as an empty dream. That idea has been rejected. What is the second idea the poet has rejected? For the soul is dead that slumbers. Look at the word. Soul is dead. Soul is dead. That slumbers. What do you mean by slumbers? Slumbers means sleeps. When a person dies, lot of people believe that soul also dies. But that is not the concept. All of you look. Soul cannot die. So the poet has rejected the ideas that lot of people believe that with the death of a person, also the soul is dying. But that idea has been rejected by the poet. What is the third idea? Look at it. And things are not what they seem. What is the meaning of seem? Seem means appear. Seem means appear. What is the meaning of seem? Seem means appear. So, and things are not what they seem. What is the meaning? What we observe in this world in our eyes, that is not real. That is not real. That is a mirage. So the poet has started the poem in a brilliant way by saying that don't tell me. Don't tell me. What is the first line? Tell me not in mournful numbers. People always in sorrowful tone, they say a lot of things in the negative way. When life is sorrow, they accept certain things which is not correct according to the poet. So that's why the first three ideas have been rejected by the poet. Now let me go to the second stanza. Life is real, life is earnest. This is the answer given by the poet. When people have doubts, then poet has clarified. What is the clarification coming? Look at the line. Life is real, life is earnest, and the grave is not its goal. Grave, all of you know, grave, you know, that is the graveyard. After death, where the body is carried away? The body is carried away to the graveyard. And graveyard cannot be the goal of life. One example I am giving. Suppose somebody asks me, what's your goal of life? Now I can answer, my goal of life is to educate, is to live a life of substance, to give certain messages to the younger generation and live a good life. I cannot say the goal of life is to die. So that's why the poet is saying, the goal of life cannot be death. This is the line. And the grave is not its goal. Now the Bible line coming, most important line, the second stanza, most important line coming. Look at the line. Dust thou art to dust thou returnest. Old English word. What do you mean by though? All of you look. What do you mean by though? Though means you. A-R-T. At means what? Art. So this is the old English word. All of you look. Dust thou art to dust thou returnest. What is the meaning of this line? Our life is made of dust. After death, it will mix with dust. This is the Bible line which is accepted by all, and this concept is also available in a Hindu mythology, in Hindu scriptures, in our culture also it is there, that our body is made of five elements, that is called Panchabhuta, and when we'll die, that will mix, our body will mix with the earth. So that idea has a similarity with the Bible as well. And what does the Bible tell you? What does the Bible tell you? Bible tells you, dust thou art, dust you are, to dust thou returnest. You will return to the dust. Was not spoken of the soul. Our body will mix with the dust, but our soul can never mix with the dust. So that's the feeling. And that's the message given by the poet by quoting a line of Bible. Now I am moving to the third stanza. All of you look. Not enjoyment, not sorrow is our destined end or way, but to act that each tomorrow finds us farther than today. Brilliant lines. All of you look. Not enjoyment and not sorrow is our destined end or way. What's the goal of a life? Enjoyment. Sorrow? No. Lots of people think that I have come to this earth to eat. What's your goal of life? Some people say eating and enjoying. But according to the poet, enjoyment is not the goal of life. Sorrow is not the goal of life. Then what's the goal of life? Answer is given. But to act that each tomorrow finds us farther than today. That has been explained in Bhagavad Gita as well. We have to work without waiting for the result. So what's the goal of a life? Goal of life is to work so that our future is better. We today give our effort, tomorrow is the result coming. But we don't have to wait for the result. So that's the answer given by the poet. What does he say? He is saying that enjoyment cannot be the goal of life. Sorrow cannot be the goal of life. Why? Lots of people in sorrow, they fail. They don't accept sorrow. They don't adjust sorrow. But that's not the goal of life. Enjoyment is also not the goal of life. What is the goal of life? To act, to do something, to be positive, to be workaholic, to achieve the target. That's the goal of life. So that our tomorrow is better. Now we are moving to the fourth stanza. The fourth stanza, what is that? Art is long and time is fleeting. And our hearts, though stout and brave, still like muffled drums are beating funeral marches to the grave. Look at the line. Art is long and time is fleeting. what do you mean by art? Art has lots of meaning. It has lot of connotations. It has lot of expressions. For example, art stands for literature. Art stands for beauty. Art stands for painting. Art stands for photography. Anything is coming under art. Art is long. All of you know the mystic smile of Mona Lisa, made by Leonardo da Vinci, is the best smile available in the world. What is the photograph? Mona Lisa's mystic smile that comes under art. Leonardo da Vinci is not available, but his work of art is available. So art has a long lasting value. William Shakespeare, he has created 37 famous plays, written lot of poems. All these poems are live now. All his plays are live now. Lot of his plays have been converted into cinemas, Hollywood and Bollywood cinemas. So what I want to say, art has a long lasting value. Time is fleeting. Fleeting means passing, temporary. What do you can't believe in time. It's passing like a river. It's going on, going on, going on. You can't stop time. You don't have the power to stop time. That's why art is long. Art has a long lasting value. It has a permanent value. But time is fleeting. Time is temporary. It is passing. You don't have the control. Next line. Still, like muffled drums and our hearts, though stout and brave. What does the poet say? Our heart, though stout and brave. What is the meaning of stout and brave? All of you look at it. Stout and brave means even strong people, army general, the captain of a ship, all are very strong person, but they have to die. Ultimately, they have to die. Even if we are stronger, we possess a strong heart, but definitely one day we have to depart. So what does the poet say here? And our hearts, though stout and brave, still like muffled drums. What do you mean by muffled drums? Muffled drums, you know, the drums covered with cotton. The drums covered with cotton. What does it signify? What does it symbolize? It symbolizes the serious sound, the deadening sound. So in the march, funeral march, there is the beating of the drums. And what kind of drums? The special drums which are covered with the cotton. And why the drums are covered with cotton? In order to make the sound serious. So our heartbeat is like the drums, like the drums covered with cotton. And it is going where? Marching to the funeral ceremony. Funeral ceremony, all of you know, the death ceremony, the last ceremony. That's why this is the line. Still, like muffled drums are beating funeral marches to the grave. Where a strong person going? Where a weak person going? Weak or strong, all have to proceed at the last towards their funeral march. So that's the message he is giving. What is the message? So art is long and time is fleeting. And time has no permanence. Time is passing away. But art has permanent value. It has a strong value. It has a permanent value. I am moving to the next stanza. All of you look at it. In the world's broad field of battle, in the bivouac of life, be not like dumb driven cattle, be a hero in the strife. So again, interesting line, very interesting line. In the world's broad field of life, our life is compared with a battlefield. Obviously correct. If I quote here the line of William Shakespeare has compared the world with a stage. World with a stage. And all the human beings are merely actors and actresses. Seven stages of life. Also a poem by William Shakespeare. And what does it signify? That all the human beings in this world pass through seven stages of life. And here the poet compares our life with the battlefield. Everybody is in the battlefield. Whether a child, whether a husband, whether a wife, whether a lover, whether a beloved, everybody is trying, everybody is struggling, everybody is facing problems. So this is the life which is compared to the battlefield. In the world's broad field of battle, in the bivouac of life, what do you mean by bivouac? Bivouac means temporary camp. Life is a temporary camp according to the poet. Why? It's right. It's absolutely correct. Why? Because what's a lifespan? No guarantee is given. Some people dying at the early stage of life, some people dying at the late stage of life, but there is no guarantee. Whatever insurance is there, whatever security is there, life has no guarantee. It's compared with a water bubble. Life is compared to a water bubble. That's why what does the poet say? In the bivouac of life, according to him, life is compared to a temporary camp. Bivouac means temporary camp. So my life, your life, his life, her life, all life compared with a temporary camp. We are on a camp. When the camp will be shifted, we do not know. So that's why in the world's broad field of battle, in the bivouac of life, be not like dumb driven cattle. Be not like dumb driven cattle. Be a hero in the strife. So what is the meaning? In the bivouac of life means, I told you, bivouac means temporary camp. Be not like dumb driven cattle. Interesting life. Be not like dumb, D-U-M-B. Dumb, a person who cannot speak is called dumb. And the poet is saying, don't behave like a dumb. You should not behave like a dumb. And what the next line? Driven cattle. What is the meaning of this line, driven cattle? Very interesting, all of you look. So driven cattle, the cowherd boy takes the cattle to a field for grazing. At that time, the cattle or individual cow don't have any opportunity of raising problems. We are human beings. We can protest. We can feel. We can complain. But cattle have no such thing. So the poet urges us, the poet demands us, we should not behave like a driven cattle. We should behave like a hero. Next line is coming. What is the line? Be a hero in the strife. What do you mean by strife? This is the word. Strife means quarrel. Strife means quarrel. He wants that we should behave like a hero. Who is a hero? Hero is that person who comes out successful in spite of problems. We have seen lot of cinemas. And in the cinemas, what is the message? Hero never dies. In the cinema, hero never dies. Why? The hero never dies. All of you know. Because hero has to give the message. Hero is a symbolic figure. And he has to survive till the last to make the world order right. What is the job of a hero? To make things right. To make the order right. So we have to behave like a hero. Why? Because we can't be defeated. We can't behave like a dumb animal. We can't be cattle. We have opinions. We have right to live. We have right to liberty. That's why we should behave like a hero. So after that, there are another four stanzas there. Just let me tell you. And what are the other stanzas there? Be a hero in the strife. Next stanza reads like this. Trust no future, however pleasant. Lot of people always say that your future is brilliant. Who say? Astrologers. When you invite astrologers to your house, definitely they see your palm. And by looking at your palm, what they say? They say, you are going to be a king. You are going to be a hero. And if you are a smart boy, you can ask the astrologer, who is my heroine? Who is my heroine? But future cannot be believed. According to the poet, there is no guarantee on future. Future is uncertain. This is the first line. Trust no future, however pleasant. Let the dead past bury its dead. Look at the line. What's the meaning? Let the dead past body is dead. That means past is dead. It is to die. It is to be forgotten. It is not to be remembered. Why? If you always think over the past, you cannot proceed. Your present will be unstable. You cannot achieve things. That's why future is uncertain, past to be forgotten. Past is dead. So what to do? This is the answer. Act. Act in the living present. What does the poet say? The present, the present time, that is the living time. We have to work on the present time because that is living. That has power. That has full of life. What? Presently I am giving you a lessons. This is my capacity. This is my ability. So I should not believe that my videos will be observed. My videos will be millions of views. That should not I think. Why? Because my effort to give best video, that is my priority. I am presently taking a class. That is my work. So that is living. That is kicking. That is alive. So what is present? The present is alive. The present is kicking. The present is life. So that's why poet advises us not to believe in future because that is uncertain. Not to believe in past. Next line. Heart within and God over it. We have to enjoy our present time. Heart within and God over it. What is the meaning? Heart within means wholeheartedly. We have to work wholeheartedly. If we don't work wholeheartedly, you cannot achieve things. One example I want to give you. Suppose Arunima Sinha. This is the example from India. Arunima Sinha lost her legs in a train accident. But she has the dream of climbing Mount Everest. Climbing Mount Everest. When she reached her guru and asked him, I want to be a mountaineer. I want to climb Mount Everest. At that time, her guru said, you are already a winner. You are already a winner. How? How does the statement come? Because Arunima Sinha doesn't have legs, but she has the great aim of climbing the Mount Everest. So that's the aim of life. That's the goal of life. So the poet says that in the last line, what does he say? We have to work hard in the present. In which sense? Heart within, God over it. Heart within, God over it. God over it, what is the meaning? We must have faith on God. We must have faith on God and we must work wholeheartedly. Next stanza. Lives of great men all remind us we can make our life sublime. Sublime means great. And departing, leave behind us footprints on the sands of time. So how can we make our life great? We can make our life great by following the lives of great men. The lives of great men give us the message to make our lives great. How can you make our life great? We can make our life great by following the lives of great men. So this is the stanza, all of you look. Lives of great men remind us we can make our life sublime, and departing, leave behind us footprints on the sand of time. So when we die, we have to give certain good work for the younger generation. Mahatma Gandhi died, but his footprints were followed. Nehru died, but his footprints followed. So what were the signs of great people? Great people never die. Great people never die. Actually, you say they die, never die. Why? Because they have lakhs of followers. They have lakhs, crores of followers. Why? Because they have done certain things good and their footprints are followed forever. Lot of young people, lot of new people always follow. So how can we make our lives great? We can make our life great by following the footprints of great people. Next stanza. Footprints that perhaps another sailing over life sullen main, a forlorn and shipwrecked brother, Singh, shall take heart again. So this is just the penultimate stanza, and this is the stanza all of you look. Footprints that perhaps another sailing over life sullen main. Life is compared with a sullen main. Main, M-A-I-N. Main means ocean. Sullen means serious. So definitely, so if somebody is in sad, if somebody is in depressed condition, how he will come across? He will come across by following the lives of great men. A forlorn and shipwrecked brother. What is the meaning? A forlorn and shipwrecked brother means a person who is defeated in life. A person who is defeated in life. What will do? Last answer. Sing shall take heart again. A defeated person can take heart again by what? By following the lives of great men. So definitely the footprints of others are always helpful. We are going to the last stanza. Let us then be up and doing. This is the first line of the last stanza. Let us then be up and doing. What do you mean by this? Up and doing means active, vibrant, energetic. You look, as a young person, you should be energetic. Even a person like 50 should be energetic. Why? I give the example of Steve Jobs, Apple phone, the owner. Okay. So what does he do? What is his message? So he lives each day of his life as the last day of his life. That is the message given by Steve Jobs. Suppose I consider that today is my last day of life. I would like to do most important things and maximum things of my life. So this is the message by the poet that we should be up and doing. What is the meaning of up and doing? Up and doing means active, energetic, and we should be fast forward. We should be fast forward. Next line. With a heart for any fate. We must have a heart for any fate. What is the meaning? We should possess a heart for any obstacles. You look at the lives of great people, Mahatma Gandhi even. So, what was the greatest message of Mahatma Gandhi? So, he is the greatest executor. He is the greatest executor of the principle of non-violence and truth. Gita has said that, Bhagavad Gita has said that, but nobody has practiced that in life. But practically Mahatma Gandhi has practiced that in life. So that's why the poet has given you the message. What is the message? With a heart for any fate, we should work for a heart for any fate. We should be ready to fight the odds of life. Still achieving, still pursuing. Every day we have to achieve. Every day we have to follow. Learn to labor and to wait. The last line. Learn to labor and to wait. We must have the patience. What does the Bhagavad Gita say here? Bhagavad Gita lines matching 100% with this line. What? We should work. Don't expect the result. Don't go after the result. Result will come automatically. So this is the last line of the poem. Learn to labor and to wait. We have to learn to do hard work and we have to wait. We have to wait. Thanks a lot for enjoying this class. In my next videos, I am going to teach some more interesting grammar as well as some new poems and some prose chapters. Have a nice day. Thank you all. Bye.